Hello everyone. We will begin at 6. So 6 na. So let me begin. Let us begin. Okay, what I done. All right. So we have different kinds of people coming in from different regions or areas in the Philippines. We have people in Metro Manila, we have people in Visayas and Mindanao. And we also have few people from Indonesia. So hi everyone, this is Eskwelabs Learning Circles. So first of all, let me introduce to you who is Eskwelabs. So we're an education technology company. We were founded in Singapore last year, and we've been operating here in the Philippines for almost a year now. And we have trained around 100 data scientists from a year of our operations. So we inspire, equip, and connect young people to opportunities of the young opportunities in the future of work through data science skills. So we have different programs and different areas of data science. We have programs for data science, analytics, and business intelligence. And our free course is the Aral-Aral. So what is Aral-Aral? So Aral-Aral is an online self-paced course for aspiring data scientists. So it brings together the best of online learning and community-based learning as an online data learning resource for everyone. So anyone can join the course for free and receive community support and participate in fun quizzes, check-ins like this one, and Q&As. So to learn more about Aral-Aral, you can check on the link provided at bit.ly Aral-Aral Learner Facts FAQs. So how can we access Aral-Aral? So first of all, you sign up using the link, Eskwelabs Aral-Aral sign up, and then check your email if you have received the confirmation. And then you can start on using the platform to learn the concepts in the LMS. And then after that, you join the community group for more updates about the learning circles. So you sign up to the learning circles individually and attend the live sessions to code along. Okay. So what are learning circles? So there are many titles presented. Learning circles is a dedicated tutorial session for the community members who wants to learn more about data science. So we're inviting everyone from the community and non-community members to join us for the month of October for more free guided sessions. So before we begin, I would like to ask everyone to download Anaconda. This is for the PC version and the Mac version. So you can follow this one. Anaconda, first of all, is a free and open source distribution of Python and R programming language. So we will use this in the next sessions for our code alongs. And then you can follow the steps provided. First, you access the link. Anaconda distribution. You can search it on Google then. And then after you have completed your download, you click on the Jupyter Notebook. So the Jupyter Notebook is the tool that we are going to use for the code alongs. So this is the Mac version. Yeah. So it's just the same. So if you haven't downloaded Anaconda, it's fine. We can use an alternative. The alternative is Google Colab. You can proceed on the link, colab.research.google.com. So it has the same functionalities as Jupyter Notebooks. So for our first session, I hope everyone to access the link, they access the notebook for the first session that our mentor will be using. So you can use this notebook to code along with Jeth. So again, it's bit.ly/OOctoberLC studentfiles. So in the first session, in the first session folder, it has the Python download requirements and the notebooks for today. So again, the topic for this day is basic Python. For the month of October, we have four sessions. The first is basic Python. The next is algorithms. And then EDA, exploratory data analysis with NumPy and Pandas. And then data wrangling with Matplotlib. So let me introduce to you our mentor for today. Hold on. Okay. So Jeth Rosia is an applied mathematical finance major at Ateneo de Manila University. He is a data science fellow at Eskwelabs from the fourth cohort of the fellowship. He was the youngest, actually, to ever graduate from our program. He is also the DSE lead at Google DSE Loyola, the Developer Student Club chapter at Ateneo de Manila University. And as a passionate learner, he tries to explore the applications and intersections of different fields like data science, economics, finance, and mathematics. And he believes that all of our institutions must make more and better data-driven decisions. So without further ado, I guess, Jeth, you can start the code alongs. Okay.
Okay, hi everyone. I'll share my screen. There. Do you guys see my screen?
Okay. Yes, we can see it.
Okay, nice. Thank you. So let's start. So welcome to today's session, which is a basic Python. I think Gerald already introduced me a while ago. So I know Python, C Sharp, and like the web development packages, and SQL and PHP. So I think even aside from this workshop, if you want help from these stuff, I think you can message me anytime. So these are the different tools that we can use, as mentioned by Gerald. If you already downloaded Jupyter or Anaconda, that's great. You can open Jupyter, but if not, you can use Google Colab. I sent the link in the chat a while ago, or you can also use IBM Watson Studio, but IBM is kind of hard to, prepare or something. You have two main options, Jupyter, but you still need to download that, or Google Colab. So, okay, let's open Jupyter. So, I already made a shortcut, but if you still don't have the shortcut, you can go to Anaconda. Anaconda. It takes a while. Okay, so we already have Anaconda open. And then in Anaconda, launch Jupyter. So there. Since I already downloaded the notebook, I won't have any problems anymore. So I already have the notebook right here. Just open it. And you can already start. So that's it. So does anyone have like some questions about it? So we can tackle it before we start. I really need everyone to like code along with me. So you really get to have a grasp of how the codes work, not just watch me like do it. Like do it with me. So if no questions, I think click yes in the participants chat if your Jupyter is now ready. Okay, great. 7 people. Okay, no more questions. Okay, great. Now let's start with the workshop, the main workshop. So what we'll learn today, so we have two parts because I don't want to overload you with the information. So the part one, we'll talk about what data is, the important preliminary functions. This is going to be very easy. Then the numeric data type, so just numbers, anything about numbers. Then arithmetic operations, so basically PEMDAS. So how will you use, how will you calculate stuff in Python? Then lastly, the variables and storing data. So after part one, we'll have a break, a 5-minute break for you guys to refresh. Then for part two, we'll study the strings, data conversions, lists, and basic indexing. So, okay, let's move. So what is data? So, according to Oxford, data are the quantities, characters, or symbols on which operations are performed by a computer. So there are two parts. So just from this sentence alone, there are two parts already. The data itself, the quantities, characters, or symbols, and the operations or functions. So what are the different types of data in Python? So these are the different data types. There are some more advanced ones like complex numbers, and other types that are not commonly used, like the tuple and sets. So we're going to focus on the main types. The integer, that's integer, not integer. Integer, float, strings, and list. So for part one, we're going to talk about integer and floats. And for part two, we're going to talk about strings and lists, which are both sequence types. So Great. Let's go to working with numbers. So here's our notebook. So okay, so since maybe some of you, this is like your first time working with Jupyter Notebooks. IPYNV files are called Jupyter Notebooks, and like each box here are called is called a cell. And to run a cell, click the cell and like Control Enter, Shift Enter, or Control Enter. Control Enter if you want to stay in the cell, and Shift Enter if you want to move to the next one. So there. Let's start with the important preliminary functions. So these are the functions. Actually, we only have two functions here. Just to help us have a better gauge of what the different data types are later. So print is used to show the number. So the difference between the two, if you use a different Python IDLE, and if you don't use a print function, it won't output 5. So you see the out thing here. In a normal Python environment, it won't really show 5 because you didn't specifically tell the computer to print 5. So now we use the print function to print 5. Then we have high. Then print high. So print, I guess I'll replace it with your name or replace it with like the name of someone you love. So I'll say, so hi, Gerald. So there. Again, you see the out thing here. In a normal Python environment, it doesn't really print hi because you didn't specifically tell it to print hi. So there's the first part. So just a first exercise for today. Try to print hello world and hello Eskwelabs. Paste your code, your one-line code. It's just a one-line code in the chat. So great. I'll wait until 6:15. Great, thanks. Hello, Eskwelabs. Okay. Okay, great. I think everyone got it. How everyone got the sense of how we use the print function. So you basically just talk to a computer this way. So let's print it. Hello, world. Hello, Eskwelabs. Okay, let's move on to the next preliminary function, which is a type function. So the type function is very useful because we use this to identify what the type of the data is. So we have here type 3. So the int, we'll discuss that later, what int is. And type 3.0, which is a float. So again, paste your answer in the chat of how we check the type of 101.1. Okay, great. Okay. Okay, I think everyone got it. It's the same answer for everyone. So type 101.1. So this is still very easy. We'll use both of these functions later. These functions are going to be very useful. So let's move to the next part, the main part. So let's move to numeric data types. Again, as mentioned a while ago, there are three numeric data types. So we have the first, which is the integer, which is this one, then the float. Then we have the complex numbers. So that's more on if you really want to delve into like mathematical computing. So integers are basically whole numbers. So 2, let's print 2. That's very simple. Then let's check the type of 2. It's an int. Check the type of 100. It's still an int. So again, basically whole numbers. They are integers. Then next we have the float. So floats are basically numbers with decimals. So 2.5. Then type 2.5. Now let's check what data type 100.0 is. So 0.0 is very important. Is it still an int or is it a float because it has a decimal? So what's your answer?
Float po.
Okay. So again, let's use the type function to check this out. So a lot of people get confused here because basically 100 is a whole number, right? But then you added a 0.0. So the computer reads it as a float data type. So now that we already know the two different data types, let's try to use arithmetic operations for the two data types. So of course we have the basic addition. So the plus sign, then the minus sign. Then for multiplication, we don't use x, we use the asterisk. Then for division, we use the forward slash. And how about this one? You noticed here that it's it outputs a float. So how about 4 over 2? We all know that 4 divided by 2 is 2, right? But still, it still outputs a float. So to output it as an integer, you must use the integer division. So in the integer division, we basically use a double forward slashes. So 3 divided by 2 is 1.5, and we just take the integer of that. So we remove all the decimal numbers. So we leave 1. Then 9, integer division 2, we have 4. Then next, this one is very this one's kind of unique because we don't really use this function in math. So we have the modulo division. So modulo division is basically getting the remainder. So what is the remainder when 8 is divided by 3? So that's basically what this statement is. So 2. So we have 6 remainder 2, so basically. Then for exponent, we use double asterisks. We don't use the, what they call this, like this symbol. We're used to use this symbol for MS Word and other stuff, but we don't use it here. We use double asterisks. 9. Then parentheses, again, also part of PEMDAS, the most important one to group like operations. So the output of this is going to be 3 plus 2, 5 raised to 2, 25. What if we remove the parentheses? It's gonna be different. It's going to do this first before adding 3. So again, the things that we study before, it still applies here in Python. So again, so this one is basically, this one should be the square root of 16, but since we didn't add a parenthesis, it would output 8. So why 8? So 16 raised to 1 divided by 2. Then how about now? Okay. Then again, I think that we need to note is that when we use an operation on a float and an int, it will always result to a float. So let's try to multiply 3 times 2.0. It's going to output 6.0. Even if we know that 6.0 is a whole number, right? Let's try to do integer division. It's still a float. So again, when you use an operation on a float and an int, the output will always be a float. So let's try to, this one's going to be a bit challenging, I think. So another exercise, let's try to find the remainder of 1070 divided by 13. You can just type your answer, if you want to show your code, then that would be great. Okay, let's try to check the answer. Four, okay. A lot of people got it. Nice. Let's now have like a harder example. So you basically code this. The code may be a bit long. So I just want to see like the main answer. For other people, I think you can private message it to me. Like send chat to Jeth Rusia. So the other people won't see the answers. I'll give you, what time is it? I'll give you until 6:27 for this one. So again, remember to use PEMDAS and the other stuff. If you have any questions while I teach, like feel free to like open your mic and stop me. We can.
Hello.
Okay. Yeah.
It says there that evaluate until 3 decimal places. So is there a way that we can limit it to 3 decimal places dun sa code?
I think for now, you don't need to. Like, just send me the answer, like, until 3 decimal places. There is a way, but, like, I still haven't teach it. So I don't want you guys to force you guys. But if you want to, it's very great. I'll just try to share music here. Do you guys hear it?
Yep.
Under a pale blue sky, never felt so cold. Another sleepless night. How could you ever let go? Thank you.
Wait, it's 627, so let's do it. I'll get the answer from my answers list. Let's try to do this. So tell me if I'm wrong. So you have 2.718 raised to 7 over 3 plus 3.14 raised to 9 over 5 all over. So you have the parentheses there. 23 times 100. So 78.924. Who got the correct answers? I mean, type your name. It's basically get the bragging rights na. Yeah, the double asterisk is important. Because, again, single asterisk for multiplication and double asterisk for exponent. So, if we read this linearly, so e raised to 7 over 3, so plus, you can add a parenthesis here, but it's not really necessary because, again, PEMDAS, it will evaluate the exponent first before evaluating the addition. So exponent first, then another exponent here, then add it all over 23 times 100. So 78.924. So yeah, just don't forget the asterisk part. It's very important. So let's move to the last part of part one. So variables. Are reserved memory locations to store values. So variables are very important because, for example, if you're going to write a very long program, you want to just have like one variable. For example, if you're going to write a program about money or like an ATM program, you need to have variables. So for example, how much money like does a certain person have? So here, let's try to evaluate the whole thing using variables. So we first declare 3 to x, then declare 5 to y, then we use the arithmetic operation that we learned a while ago. Then again, now let's try to do this. So declare 4 to x, then add 1 to x. But like, what would the value of x be? It's still 4. Because we didn't update the value of x. So it's important that we update the value of x. A lot of people like have a lot of problems here. So for declare a value of 4. Then if you want to update the value of 4, you can declare another one again. So the first part, so x is 4. Then moving on to the next line. So 4 plus 1. Now x is 5. Because again, you updated the value of x. Unlike for this one, you didn't really update the value of x. Now, you can also have like other variable names, other like fancy variable names. So hello equals 2, then world equals 3. Then we update the value of hello to 4. So let's try to print both variables. So since you updated the value of hello, the 2 value is not valid anymore. Since it's overwritten, so that's a writer. It's overwritten by the latest line. When you print world is not affected because you only declared it once. So I think just to note this, there are like some variable naming rules. I won't really like discuss each specifically, but then it must begin with a letter or an underscore. This is going to be very important. Then other characters can be letters, numbers, or underscores. Basta you begin with a letter or an underscore. It can't be a number. Then variables are also case sensitive. So hello, everything small with hello caps lock is different. Then it can be any reasonable length. So I think you can have a variable with like 100 characters. So I mean, I don't know, like a paragraph as a variable, but it's going to be very unnecessary, right? Because you're going to use a variable again in the next parts of your program. then don't use functions name, function names. Again, we discussed a while ago, the print function and the type function. Don't create a variable using print and using type. You can play with it and it's gonna be very confusing. There are gonna be problems with your system. You won't be able to use the print and type functions anymore. So now, let's have like a little exercise. Which variable names are allowed? Just type your answer in the chat. So let's go with number one. So Apple. Is this variable name allowed or not allowed? Wait, okay, so people said it is. Yes, it is allowed because we follow the rules. It's all it started with a letter, then the other characters are still letters. Let's move to number two. I123D. Is this allowed or not allowed? Okay, yes, yeah, still allowed though. Okay, so still we still follow the naming rules. So we started with a letter, then followed with numbers, then ended with a letter. Now, the letter at the end is not really important. It can still be a number. Doesn't matter. Basta you start with a letter or an underscore. Let's move to number three, 44. Is this a valid variable name? Okay, great. Not allowed though. Because yeah, you didn't start with a letter or an underscore. So cancel na agad si number, si number 30. This is not allowed because it's going to be very confusing for Python. How will Python know that 44 is a variable or an integer that you just want to like place there? Then next, number 4. Is number 4 an allowed variable name? Okay, nice. So it started with an underscore, then other characters followed. Again, still reasonable length, of course. Then it's not a function name. Then lastly, how about number 5? Is number 5 allowed or not allowed as a variable name? Okay, nice. Oh yeah, it's not allowed because you didn't start with a letter or an underscore. So, okay, that's great. I think everyone understands. Then let's wrap up part one before we move on to the second part. So we studied the print function, type function. So you basically talk to a computer. So print hello, send hello to a computer. Then type 3.45. So check the type, the data, type of the data. Which we can see here is a float. Then we try the different operators. So adding, so 3 plus 4.0, which is going to be 7.0. Then declaring variables. So there. So yeah, so part one is now done. So we have a 5-minute break. We can continue at 6:41. If you have questions like about this part, or you know, about me or about the Eskwelabs, you can ask this while we're on break. But yeah, feel free to like grab coffee, water, or snacks. A 5-minute break. Yeah, there will be a coffee. This session is now recorded. Okay, while we're on break, does anyone have any questions? I think it's no questions right now. Okay, none of them. I hope everyone still understands the first part. These are very fundamental for the next sessions. Because for the next session, we're gonna work with algorithms, so the if statements. So if blank is 2, if x is 2, what will happen? If x is 4, what will happen? And else, and stuff like that. So controlling what should happen, not really doing everything. What version of Python will be used? Any? Version 3. Like, no one really uses version 2 anymore. Hello? Do you have a question? I don't know anyone who uses Jupyter for Python version 2. But I think there is. But since no one's really using Python 2 anymore, it's best that we move to Python 3. Yeah, I use a shortcut for Jupyter. So I think I basically went to I'll share my Google screen again. So okay, you can now see my Google screen. I basically went search for Jupyter notebook in the a Windows search bar, then. The shortcut. Oh no, mali pala. Here. Pin to taskbar. Para madali na. Kasi I find it hassle to because for others, you still need to open Anaconda before you open Jupyter. And it's very hassle. So, I mean, you can go here or you can pin it to taskbar. For people like me who use Jupyter a lot, I don't want to go through the whole process again and again. Again, and those who are interested to join the other sessions, I think this is the best way to pin it to your taskbar. So it wouldn't be very hard to search it pa. The next cohort. Okay, cohort 5 already started. Pero wait, Gerald, are you there? When will cohort 6 start?
Hello.
Yes.
I think cohort 6 will start sometime in January. So it will still be the same type of setting. Since we can't go back yet in our usual operation, the boot camp will still be online. So yeah, I hope that answers your question. Sometime in January, but we haven't fully planned it yet. When the start will be, but it will still be the same.
I think you can and follow Eskwelabs' Facebook page to keep updated. Or naka-on your notifications sa Facebook page. Okay, someone asked how to pin again. Okay, wait, what happened? I'm still sharing my screen. Okay, nice. Go to the. Do you see this part of my screen? The search bar beside the Windows button on the lower left side. So, search Jupyter, then pin the taskbar. So this part. Gets baguettes or, yes. Okay, nice. Thank you. Then the next session will be on October 7th. Okay, yeah. I think we can continue. Yeah, great. So let's continue now with wait a second. There. With this, so part 2 will be about basic sequences. Let's go back to. Okay, very nice. So let's move to this part. So, a while ago, we worked with numbers. We're now going to work with sequences. So, not basically words, but like any sequence. So, string. So the most common definition of string is it's a set of characters enclosed in double or single quotation marks. So, like this one, is this a string or a variable? This is a variable, right? Because there, yun nag-error siya kasi we didn't declare hello world as a variable a while ago. So, to define a string, you need to enclose it in quotation marks. So, there. So, let's check. So, yun. So, this is the third data type. Again, to review, we studied integers and floats. So, this is the third one. So, string. So, how about 1, 2, 3 enclosed in quotation marks. Again, based on the definition, set of characters enclosed in double or single quotation marks. 1, 2, 3 here is still a string. So, yeah. Well, printing 1, 2, 3 and print 1, 2, 3 as a number. So, okay, let's try to print this one. And print 1, 2, 3 as an integer. So the output is the same, but they're of different data types. Now let's try to declare a string to a variable. So same process, x equals the string, then print x. So there, we declared x as like quote unquote the string happy. Then if we print it, it's gonna output happy. Now another exercise with the same given items, but now identify the type of the following items. How about number one, without the quotation marks? What is a date? Is this a data type or a variable? Remember, there's no like quotation marks yet. Okay. Yeah, variable pa lang siya. Kasi wala pang quotation marks. So how about number two? Is a variable, a string, an integer, a float? Yeah, also variable. Okay, nice. So same example sa bago. How about number three? 44. What is the data type of 44? Okay, int. Nice, nice. How about number four? Quote unquote I123D. What's the data type of this one? Yan, okay, string na siya. And for the last one, quote unquote 22.5. So we know that 22.5 is a float, right? But with the quotation marks, is it still a float or is it now a string? String. Okay, also string. String G. Okay, nice. Yeah, it's still a string. It's now a string because we with the quotation marks. Now let's move to the next part. So how do we convert data types? Like what we saw here a while ago, 22.5 is supposed to be a float, but because there are like quotation marks, it's a string. So let's try to convert it. So let's declare x as 125.0. Let's convert this. We know that 125.0 is a float, right? Let's convert this into a string. So same thing, just with the quotation marks on the side. Now let's convert 125.0 into an int. So there, it just removes like all the decimal places on the side. So let's try to add, say, 5, 4, 3 string. Like same thing, just add like quotation marks on the side. Then int, still 125. It just removes all the decimal values. Now let's try this. So there's a function inside another function. So to evaluate this, we check the first, like the ones in the inside first. So int x is 125, then string is Yeah, 125 as a string. So now let's try this one. Y equals 55, so an integer. Then converting an integer into a float. It just adds a 0.0 there. So that's the dynamics there. So if you convert a float to an int, it just removes all the integers on the side. Then if we convert an int to a float, it just adds a 0.0 there. So, okay, let's add a new one. I forgot to add this. What if we add, like, say, nobody can pala. Okay, this is kind of obvious. 125.543. So, if we do this, again, evaluate the inside first. So, the inside will be 125. Then, make it a float. So, it's going to be 125.0. In first look, we're going to assume that it doesn't make sense. Because it's just going to go back to its original form, right? It's just going to go back to its original data type. But then, here we see it evaluates the inside first before evaluating using the outside function. So now let's try this one. So what is the output of this one and why is it the output? So I think all of you... Is it 55? Okay, others say it's 55, others say it's invalid. So let's try to run it. Para sure. Let's try to run it. So it's invalid. Okay, why is it invalid? First, we converted 55.0 into a string. Then we're trying to convert a float in a string to an integer. So to the way to get away from this is to, again, convert it to a float first. So if we do this, sana siya gagana. We can directly... convert it. But how about this one? Yeah, wala siyang error. Because it's a given na walang other points. Let's try 55A. Okay. 55A. X. So, yan. Error din siya. Because there's a character that doesn't belong to an integer. Again, integers are just composed of like whole numbers. So, this doesn't work. So... Now, we're okay. Let's move to the next data type. So again, review. We have the integer, then we have the float, then we have the string. So now, we have the list. So what is a list? So if you have like background in other programming languages, this is an array. So it's a set of characters, a sequence of elements. It's mutable, changeable, and ordered. So it's very important to note that lists are mutable. So mutable, same thing with changeable, and ordered. Because there are other array types in Python that are not changeable and not ordered. So you define a string with the brackets. The brackets, right? So 1, 2, 33, that's it. Then it can also be a sequence of floats. Yeah, a sequence of strings, by the way. Then it also can have like variables inside. So declare 2 to x, then 5 to y, then 13 to z. So let's try to run this. So there. Ay, lagay lang yung laman ng variable. So then we can also have a list of lists. So you have the main list, then inside the list there are 4 more lists with different items inside of them. So this is also allowed. Let's try to run this. Again, say the same thing. Then we can also have this. This is kind of amazing, right? So for the first one, string of 99.9, then second one, type of 99.9. So string 99.9 with a quotation marks again, confusing part. Then type, which is a float. Then same with this one. So what is a type of this. We inside the list are two integers. But then what's the type of the whole data type? It doesn't evaluate the items in the list. It just evaluates the whole list. So yeah, it outputs this. Then again, for lists, the beautiful thing about lists is that the data types inside doesn't need to be the same. So you have, or we already have four data types here. So true is a Boolean. So we'll discuss this in the next session. So yeah, attend the next session too, so we can study Booleans. You have an int, then you have a float, then you have a Boolean, then you have a string. So if we run this and check the type is still a list. So again, for me, list is like the most beautiful thing in Python because it's very flexible. Other arrays in other languages, you need to declare how many items there will be inside, what data type it will be. But here in Python, the data type, inside the data type of the items inside the list are flexible. So questions, can you use parentheses or braces for lists specifically, not other arrays? Okay, so other people answered already. So the answer is no. You can't use others. You really need to use the brace, the brackets, I mean. Because if you use the parentheses or the braces, some braces, am I right? If you use parentheses, it will be a tuple. So tuple is another data type. So it's an array. But I mean, personally, it's very ugly because you can't change the things inside. Then for braces, you can also use braces for dictionaries. But braces with the same concept, for example, for this one. Let's try to... Oh my god, wait. So... Okay, let's try to copy this. Let's try to replace the brackets with parentheses. Let's check the type. It's going to be a tuple. So again, tuples are immutable. So you can't change the items inside. Then now let's try to use braces. So it's going to be a set. So that's as far as I remember, it's like the same with like mathematical sets. If you already had like a math 10 subject, mathematics in modern world subject in your school, sets are unordered. So unlike lists, so if you change, if you place 3.3 in front of 2, the list will be different. Unlike for sets, it will still be the same. So now that we studied strings and lists, let's try to play with it a little bit. So this is basic indexing. So index, what's an index? It's a position within an ordered list. So for example, we have the list here, and I want to get like items in the list. So if I want to get cats, how will I call cats inside the list? So again, let's have our initial list that we're gonna use. Then, so indexing, as you see here, so note, indexes start at 0. So indexes of lists and start 0. Or like sequences in general in Python, they all start in 0, not 1. So if I call x0, so the output will be A, the first item. So this is how you call the index. So if you read this, call the item in list x at index 0. So there, then 5. So we try to check this. So A is at index 0, B is at index 1, C is at index 2, D is at index 3, Eskwelabs, the string Eskwelabs, is at index 4, then 100 as an integer is at index 5. So we call that, so that's 100. So what if we call an item like not inside the list? So we call the item at index 400 in list X, even if we know that X, the max index in list X is just until 5. So it will be an error. So there. Then 1, 2, 4, we can call a list of a list of items from a list. So basically how we read this is items 1, 2, 3. So we don't include the last one. So this is actually weird, but this is how it works in Python. So we don't include the last one. So x1 to 4. So if we use this list, it will input a list from bar to qx, bcd. Then another thing here, we can also change like an item in the list. So x1, so we call the first item in list x, so that's b, then replace it with banana. Let's try this one. So there, we can't see b anymore. It's already replaced with the string banana. Now let's try, let's move to strings. So again, as mentioned, even if strings and lists are not really alike, in function, in essence, in code, they are. So lists, strings are just sequences of characters. So again, for example, if you have the string hello world, it can be seen as like the sequences of H E L L O space is included, then W O R L D. So let's try a different string. Para may iba naman. So we have happy birthday, including the exclamation mark. So let's declare that as our new variable. So what would the output of this be? So let's try to check this first. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it will, it should output B, if we're right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's B. Then, again, same with lists. We can do like a set of strings. So 0 to 7. So it starts at 0. So H, A, P, P, Y, space, B. I at index 7 is not included because, again, we don't include the last one. Happy B. Okay. Then again, we can have a third one. So from 0 to 7. So what's the third one? The third one is a step. So let's try to check this. So H E Y B. So if it's the string we use, it's gonna start at H, then skip 1, 2, L. Then 1, 2, O. Then 1, 2, W. And again, not including the last one. So for happy birthday, start with H, step 1, 2, P, then another step 1, 2, Y, then another step D. So yeah, why is this important? Because you'll have different types of programs that you might need to skip. For example, if you have code, for example, if you extract something, then it has like space in between. For example, if there's a picture of an essay that you want to copy or you want to encode, you can actually do it in Python. And if it has spaces, then you just want to skip the spaces, right? And there's a pattern that you already know the pattern. You can do this the skips and use this to get the other one. So let's check again X. So we can have multiple indexing. So we have this list. So we know that we can get the index of a list, and we also know that we can get an index from a string. So for this one, this is an important one. So get the item in the list X at index 1. So this is index 1, so banana. Then get the character and the string banana at index 2. Okay, wait. Okay, there. So again, for this part, it extracted banana. Then you use a second. You took or extracted again the item, the character at the second index, which is n. So there, very cool. So another exercise going to be the last exercise sadly for today. Try to get like the string 3LP1 from this string. So you can, since it's this last exercise, again, PM it to me. Like the code, how you will get it. It's going to be very short. But you really need to count. I'll do, yeah. So I'll give you until, I can give you until 7:05. I mean, 7:07, 7:08. So if you want like a copy here. I think this one is going to be the most useful one for this part. Just find like the pattern. How will you get the 3LP1? So while we wait for answers, do you have questions? Does anyone have questions about like the whole thing? For the others, don't forget the skip, the third variable. Okay, again, don't forget the third, and not variable, but the third input. That's going to define like how you get the items in the list. Okay, it's 7:07, and a lot of people already gave their answers. So let's try to so nice. Other people did 21, 22, still going to be okay. 23 is actually still okay. I don't think you can start at zero. Because if you start at zero, it will be different. So the start is very important. So start at 4. So the first one is 3. Until the index 21 or 20, which is space or F, for 5 steps. And again, the last part that you mentioned here, wouldn't it's not part of the thing anymore. So I hope everyone got that. So wrapping up like the second part. So we studied string. So 124.4 enclosed in quotation marks is a string. Then converting floats to ints, or like the conversion of data types in general. So there's 33. Then lists. So let's print this list. Then taking the index. So we're gonna use this list. The third item. The item at index 3, I mean, so the fourth item, cats. Then taking the thing at index 2 is going to be okay. That's the end of the notebook. And for next week, we're gonna study algorithms. So we're gonna study booleans. So true or false, true or false, and true and false. Then comparing the data types. So okay, let's add it here. So is 3 equal to 3.0, stuff like that, or is 3 equal to string 3 false? We're gonna use this next week. Then we're also gonna study conditionals. So if statements, else statements. If you notice it, the things that we studied today, they're all very, very linear. That they're gonna do everything that we say. But like next week, we're gonna apply if statements. So, for example, if we declare x as 5, if x is 4, then do this. So since x is 5, it won't do the command inside the if statement. Then we're also gonna study loops. So instead of typing like a lot of print hello world, you can do a loop and just print it using 3 lines of code. So very efficient. So yes, stay tuned for next week's session. So any questions for this session or like other stuff that you got confused with?
I have a question.
Yeah, go.
There's a part, part G for list the type.
Part G. What's part G? List? Tama ba?
Yeah. Dun sa, it says 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Dun sa 6 na line. X equal to 999.
Okay.
Yung second item on the list, yung float, what kind of data type is that? Because I tried to type it a while ago and then parang nag-error siya and like...
Huh? Wait, really? The type of this? Tama ba? Yeah. Kanto ba? It's a type.
Like kasi diba...
The type of the variable, ito ba?
The type of the type X.
Yeah, so this one?
I tried to do type, tapos X, tapos brackets with 2.
Brackets with 2, wait. Let's try to...
Kasi diba second item? Aha, okay, never mind.
Okay, wait.
I realized my mistake kasi it wasn't really named a list 2 variable.
Yeah. Okay. But yeah, if you take the type of the whole list, it will still get there. No, it's okay. It's it's a very valid question. It's great.
Okay,
so you try. Other questions. It's a great question, to be honest. So it's kind of confusing, Anamar, what the type of the type is. Other questions. I think if there are no more questions, we can have like a photo together. So open your cameras. Are you G with that? Like open your cameras. So I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. How are you guys? Na stress ba kayo?
Okay. For participants. Okay. I'll take the photo na lang, Jeth.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so here we go. 1, 2, 3, smile. Okay, next page. Madami. Okay, 1, 2, 3, smile. And last, 1, 2, 3, smile. Okay, thank you.
So, yeah, if you have no more questions, please stay tuned for next week's session.
Okay. Thank you.
So it's my turn, Jeth.
Yeah.
So, okay, guys. So, thank you for attending today's session. So, if you have questions regarding Python, you can ask Jeth. And if you have questions regarding Eskwelabs, you can ask me. So for those who are interested to join the Data Science Fellowship, here is the process. So first is you go into the Aral-Aral pre-course. So if you have completed the pre-course or attended at least three learning circle sessions, you are eligible to receive a certificate. So after this one, you need to complete two more sessions to receive a certificate, and then you answer the assignments in the LMS. So use the same process that I have said before. And then, again, after you have taken up the learning circles and the assignments, you take on the data science fellowship assessment. So here we assess your skills in terms of Python and statistics and in critical thinking. So, ayan, so Jeth is actually one of our first Aral-Aral scholar. So he received a full degree. He received a full ride scholarship at Eskwelabs since he performed very well at the Aral-Aral pre-course before. And then you get to be interviewed by our admissions officer. So here you can chat more about our more about your plans for the future as a future data scientist if you want to become a data scientist. For those who are also interested to solve problems using data science, you can check in on our website. So Jethro's capstone project is also located in this section. So you can check more about Jeth's project. So it's about properties, right, Jeth? So real estate. So they're analyzing real estate. And
wait, sorry, nakamute pala ako. Yeah, it's about condominium prices.
Yeah.
In Metro Manila.
It's predicting prices, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, you can check on the this link that bit.ly/DSC4projects. So these are all the projects that are done by our fellows. So again, thank you everyone. So we hope to see you in the next sessions for the algorithms. So register for the next bit.ly October LC and then answer the feedback form so that we can see those who have attended today's session. So, ayon. Hope to see you in the next sessions and have a great evening and hope you have a nice dinner. Yeah. So let's play a little bit of music.
GG.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Okay, next. Last room. Oh, wait, my question. For N, sadly, no, but we'll teach the basics of data science. So data wrangling and all those stuff. So if you want to learn ML, you can join the Eskwelabs bootcamp and we'll be like very, how do you say this? Comprehensive. The boot camp is not free, but if you get the Eskwelabs Aral-Aral scholarship, just like the scholarship that I got, it's like 100% free. So yeah, make sure to like take the assessments for Aral-Aral and like stay tuned for like all sessions.
Yeah. Oh, actually, for N, maybe I can read something. So we're developing Aral-Aral Plus. So it's we're going to release Aral-Aral Plus too. It contains a little bit of introductory lessons too. So ayan, it's going to be a great version also, but not that high price as much as the book.
Yes, may schedule. Then, super saya niya kasi hindi siya yung normal na online class na ikaw lang yung magsasagot. May mga kasama kang ibang students. So, yung iba mga graduates na, iba mga nagma-master's degree, yung iba mga nag-leave ng trabaho, gusto kumuha ng bagong trabaho. So, makaka-meet ka ng mga bagong tao. So, may schedule talaga siya. So, regular yung classes, may mga group activities and stuff. Quite online, super saya.
Friend, yes, pwede naman under 18. Just ay, under 18, 16.
The 18 ako nun sumali. Saktong 18, bago mag-19.
Pwede naman. As long as,
consent ng parents.
Tapos. Yeah.
Or if you have comments like that you want to say right now, you can like unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Is a lesson too fast or are there like too many topics in one day? Is it overwhelming?